All right, so it's time for another recruiting update here in Season 2 of the Illinois Tech Dynasty. And yes, I am quite aware we just did a recruiting update for Week 4, but a lot of things have changed on the board, so why not try to get a lot of that stuff covered here in a Week 5 recruiting update before I start doing post-game updates and you guys are like, who are these guys? So obviously, we just came off a pretty upsetting loss to the Bearcats of Cincinnati, 28-49, the worst loss we've taken in program history. Last year, we took a 30-49 loss to Notre Dame, and this past game was just frustrating. The offensive line wasn't playing well. The defense wasn't getting pressure. And that's what recruiting's for. We got to find players to help fill some of those gaps and help make this team better. And I feel like we've kind of done a pretty good job with recruiting so far. 17 players recruited and brought in last year, some of them being redshirted. Some of them are starting this year. And we're going to hope to find some more starters in this recruiting class, starting with Marcus O'Brien. And I still don't know where he's going to play exactly, but he's good at everything. So maybe he'll just adopt that Jabril Peppers role for us and play safety, receiver, quarterback, running back. And he's finally ready for a visit. So he'll come in this week, Week 5, for a last-minute visit to Illinois Tech. So trying to add some quick points there to get a commitment from him as early as possible. Jarrett Johnson, middle linebacker from Selma, Alabama, a guy that is purely a pass rusher. He won't be covering anybody. And I talked about bringing him in and moving him to outside linebacker, and I totally forgot that we have 7 outside linebackers currently on the roster, and none of them are graduating this year, so it's kind of a waste to bring him in and move him to outside linebacker, but maybe we redshirt him for a year. Always an option, but he's ready for a visit as well. He'll come in this week with Marcus O'Brien, get that complimentary visit bonus of 50 points. Now moving on to Larson Decker, the safety from Anaheim, California, who's being very difficult. And honestly, the only reason why I'm allowing him to be difficult is because he has exactly what I want in a safety, especially a free safety. He has great range. He has great coverage ability, or at least his own coverage. That 70 man is going to be an issue, but he's not ready for a visit. Almost. We'll try to get that scheduled next week. But in case we can't get Larson Decker, there's always Noah Harrell, 6'3", 199, the JUCO safety from Palm Bay, Florida. Has very good range like Larson Decker, but definitely not as good in coverage, especially zone coverage. So there's a good chance that Noah Harrell could come in and play strong safety. Maybe we redshirt him for a year, let Gabe Hunter get his senior year in, and then Noah Harrell is ready to come in and start in 2 seasons. But he'll also come in Week 5 with O'Brien and Johnson. Marcus Webster, one of my favorite corners on the board from last week. Hint, hint, we found some more guys. Pretty good speed, pretty good coverage ability, actually great coverage ability for a freshman, but not a great tackler, not very good getting off blocks, but he'll also come in Week 5, and we'll talk about why that is in a second. A lot of guys coming in this week for visits. Now moving on to Cole Hardy, the other corner. Don't like him as much as Marcus Webster, but again, another guy that could potentially play safety, although that tackling rating is a little concerning. Not ready for a visit, but moving on to Richardson, the guard from Inglewood, California, 6'7", 315. What a talent he could be. 81 pass block, 81 run, and 72 impact. Definitely a day one starter for this team, and now ready for a visit. He'll be coming in Week 8, not Week 5 with the other guys, Week 8. And let me explain why. So we'll move into the skill upgrades for head coach Chris Hall, now level 10, and all the points so far have been put into recruiting, but we are only 1 of 3 tiers into the closer, which will give us an extra 500 points per tier for Weeks 8 through 15. So my thinking is get as many skill players in as possible during this week. Hopefully get a lot of those points off the board, free up some space, and then give those points to the offensive linemen. And then when it's time for those linemen to come in and visit, they are going to have so many points plus their visit bonuses. Now moving on to tight end Justin Mullins from Glenview, Illinois. We got to start building this Illinois pipeline. He's listed as a blocking tight end. Obviously, you can see that, but I'm looking at his break tackling, his trucking, his elusiveness. This guy will be playing fullback next year, so Jay Miller will have a good chance to move back to tight end number 3 behind Archer and Edwards. Now moving on to Charlie Daniels, the tackle from Wichita, Kansas. Another guy I like quite a bit, coming in with 75 pass, 75 run, and 86 impact, which is very good. Definitely won't be seeing the field next year. He will have a redshirt season this upcoming year and be able to maybe start in 2 seasons, but also not ready for a visit quite yet, so we'll talk about him later. Now moving on to David James, who has a pretty good chance of starting, maybe. 77 pass, 78 run, 81 impact. Maybe he'll have a redshirt season as well. We've got 3 guards who will be seniors next year and 1 who's graduating this year, so a good chance for David James to have a starting role in a couple of years, but he'll come in Week 8 as well. And we just talked about this, but the goal bonuses for the offensive linemen coming in for visits are very easy to get, especially against a team like Miami, Ohio. Now moving on to Marcus McNamara, the defensive end from Temple Terrace, Florida. Not too sure why I'm looking at defensive ends with Corbin and McKenzie, but maybe he has a chance to develop in a couple years. But moving on to Patrick Hawkins, defensive tackle from Vidor, Texas, JUCO, player that I like quite a bit. Pretty interested in Illinois Tech and what we're doing, and obviously he's got a good skill set. The only question is that speed and that agility. How quick is he going to be able to get to the QB with that power move at 84, which is very good, but also ready for a visit coming in week 5. We're not holding off till week 8. He's coming in week 5. Moving on to outside linebacker Dan Sellers, who is very interested in a lot of things that we do here at Illinois Tech. 6'3", 227, and definitely the best outside linebacker we're going to have on the team next year. I might end up redshirting him. I don't know yet. His coverage ability really intrigues me to have him play next year, but we have 7 outside linebackers on the roster and no one's graduating, so kind of a interesting situation. But moving on to Brian Harris, Yorba Linda, California, defensive tackle. Not as tall as Hawkins, not as big, but a little quicker. But Harris also has a lower skill set than Hawkins, especially with his power move and his finesse move, so we'll see how that works out. Moving on to wide receiver Oliver Carson from Alliance, Ohio, 5'11", 184. Definitely a small, shifty guy, ran a 4.4 flat 40, but he also can't really catch the ball, and his route running's not great, more of a special teamer, and that's probably one of the main reasons why I'm not really putting a lot of points into him. He's a slow burner. There's no other teams really interested in him right now. Same thing with Corey Perkins, only 15 points plus the 3.10 bonus we're getting for him. And he's a pretty solid punter, good size, 6'3", not very fast, but he's ready for a visit. And with Lewis coming back for his senior year, Corey Perkins will have a year to develop and will hopefully be able to bring him in and have him start in 2 seasons. No movement in Christian Chambers, still leading for him, but DeAndre Mackey, a subscriber back on the board. Welcome back to the board. We are climbing your board pretty steadily. But obviously a name missing here from Asher Yodea, 6'2", 220, the number one middle linebacker out of Chicago, Illinois. Unfortunately, a move that had to happen to free up points for guys that are actually showing interest in us despite Yodea's talent. And he went off the board last week because he was visiting Purdue this week. And I'm pretty much expecting a commitment to Purdue after his visit. So moving on to recruits that are not being very heavily looked at. I really recommend that if you're doing a dynasty, you start looking at guys that are under very low lock percentages once you get to like week 4, week 5, guys like Roy McCarthy from Ellesmere, Delaware. These are normally guys that aren't being recruited very heavily or not being recruited at all, and a lot of them could be pretty good players. You just got to do the scouting for them, and I really recommend that you stay away from guys that are over 24%, maybe 23%. But you have to do the scouting, and I've found a couple players I'm actually pretty interested in. Starting off with Jamal Foster, 6'6", 257, the 50th ranked defensive end out of Lake Havasu, Arizona. I can't believe I almost missed this guy. Crazy size, but also very good speed for that size, and also very good at block shedding. And comparing him to Quentin McKenzie, who we brought in last year, doing the same thing, adding players late with low lock percentages and trying to bring them in. Very interested in Jamal Foster, and we're the only team offering him a scholarship so far, and it looks like no one's really recruiting him very heavily. Notre Dame, his number one team, but hopefully not for long. Moving on to athlete Roman Smith from Concord, California, 6 foot even, 189 pounds, 4-star caliber recruit, and a guy that could play quarterback. I mean, he's got really good speed. He can also catch the ball, but he's not, you know, that fast to play receiver, but the throw power and throw accuracy, very good. Could be a very dangerous player for this offense, but obviously we've got a little bit of a situation going on at QB that I talked about in the last episode, but it's not like we haven't been recruiting like legit quarterbacks. I've looked at Harold Miller. This guy is 6'7", 230 with 88 speed, 81 agility, 81 acceleration, throw power at 85. I mean, this kid is incredible. The break tackles at 79, the elusiveness at 89, and we tried to bring him in. He was on the board weeks 1 to week 3, 500 points through each week, and we weren't making any progress. There's a good chance he's playing at Eastern Michigan, and I'm a little afraid to play them next year. Andre Haith for a running back from Parkville, Maryland, and this kid looks dangerous. He's got a pretty similar skill set to Bishop. He can't catch as well as Bishop, but he's definitely a better quote-unquote pure running back. So definitely a guy that I would like to bring on the team next year. We're putting a lot of points into him, and we're getting a little bit of a response, so we're going to hope to see that continue to trend forward as we're pretty far back on his board. Blake Sherman, wide receiver from Aberdeen, Mississippi. Receiver, again, not a big position of need for us, but I like Sherman because he's got decent speed, and he's also got great route running, which is a problem for the receivers we have now. A lot of these guys aren't very good route runners, and that's one reason why we have a lot of issues getting separation and man coverage. Right now, Texas A&M is his number one team, but he's also 14% locked, so a good chance to get back in the race. Moving on to kicker Zach Carroll. Obviously, Jerron Kelsey on the recruiting update for last week, putting 500 points into him, still losing that battle to NIU. I said, you know what, NIU, have Jerron Kelsey. We'll take another kicker, Zach Carroll, a guy I like quite a bit, 79 kick power, 79 accuracy, and he's 6'4". And he's actually kind of quick for his size. I'm actually kind of excited to bring him in. But Zach Carroll, you know, making some good progress with him. He's from Georgia. Georgia is number one team. And we'll see if we can pull off a comeback there. Defensive end, Mickey Avery from Bryan, Arkansas, comes in 6'2", 242, the 70th defensive end in this class. And if we can't get Jamal Foster, there's a good chance I might go after Avery. Although Avery is going to take a long time to develop. Nowhere as quick as Jamal Foster, nowhere near as talented, but you know, he's a good starting point. We're making some good progress with him. But obviously, defensive end, not a huge area of need for, so maybe he won't be on the board for that long. I'm just looking for other guys. Kevin Burns, moving on to corner. We have seven corners on our board right now, and Kevin Burns is kind of in the middle of those seven corners. He's got good speed. I mean, it's not great, it's okay. He's got really good man and zone coverage, better press than the guys we have now. And the tackling's kind of along the line of, you know, coverage corners, but we're making pretty good progress with him. We'll check on him in a couple minutes, see how far he's progressed in week six. Brian McKinney was a guy that had us number one on his board. I never looked at him for some reason, and I'm a little upset that I didn't, but at the same time, I don't really think that he's a great need for us. Again, we have four freshman corners this year. We have two redshirting, and we only have one graduating. So a little bit of a question whether or not McKinney will be a fit for us next season. But then again, he is a guy that could come very cheap, so I'm not exactly upset with having him on the board so far. But moving on to Pete Davis from Wine, Arkansas, 6'2", 183, by far my favorite corner on our board right now. I like him more than I like Webster, and that goes a long way. 92 speed, 92 acceleration, 89 agility. The strength, you know, is pretty average for a corner, 64 tackling, which is okay. The pursuit's great, the play rec's great, the coverage is okay. He's got pretty good press, and he's also very good at block shedding, a lot better than the other guys we have on the team. But unfortunately, we're not the only team showing interest in Pete Davis. There goes Southern Miss, 215 up from last week. They've also offered him a scholarship, so we're probably going to have to match that offer and do something with him. But Kevin Godfrey, 6'2", 169 from Jacksonville, Florida, 92 speed, 92 acceleration. The agility is 78, a little concerning. He's not a great tackler either. Block shed is okay, the press is pretty bad, the man coverage is pretty average. So Kevin Godfrey, he's okay, but then again, you know, I like having, you know, guys that could play special teams. And Kevin Godfrey with that speed could be a great gunner. Then moving on to Johnny Glover, and a guy that's very small, 5'9", 166, but if you look at this guy's ratings, his 90 press is like ridiculous. 83 man coverage, 83 zone, 62 pursuit, a little concerning, but 82 play rec is very good for a corner, which would keep him from getting, you know, fooled at the line of scrimmage on play action. He'll be able to stay with receivers downfield, but the speed, definitely an issue. But we're seeing a very good response from him, so another guy that I could consider, you know, bringing on the team and maybe playing slot, but then again, that agility is a little concerning. But then we've got quarterback Kevin Fields, the number six quarterback in this class from Plant City, Florida, Pipeline, 6'3", 186, and a cannon, and an accurate cannon. This isn't a Jay Cutler. This is a guy that has an arm, and he knows where to put the football, and he's also got some pretty decent wheels. 78 speed's not horrible, but if you compare him to Sean Kelly right now, 79 throw power and 81 throw accuracy. So a guy that can definitely help this team stretch downfield, as we really can't do anything vertical with Sean Kelly, but we just added him onto the board this week. So we'll see how far we get with Kevin Fields in a second. But moving into week six, and we're going to get our first commitment along with some pretty solid visits from the guys that we brought in. But Noah Harrell, our first commitment. And it also looks like Larson Decker is finally ready for that visit. So we get a gym prospect, we get several 500 plus ratings. So not a bad week for Illinois Tech Wolfpack football. Moving into the top classes, I can finally take a look at this because we finally have a commitment. Right now, 73. We were 51, I believe, at the end of last year. I believe we might crack, if we get the guys we're looking for, we might crack the top 30. this year. But Larson Decker finally ready for a visit, but we're still steadily falling down his board. We have him on the board for week 8. He visits Minnesota week 11, West Virginia week 14. I'm a little concerned we might lose Larson Decker, but moving on to tight end slash fullback Justin Mullins. Also ready for a visit, pretty far along his lock percentage. So I'm not really worried about Illinois or Northwestern. He does have Iowa right behind us on his active board, and he visits them in week 14, but he'll come in week 8. Now Charlie Daniels, the tackle from Wichita, Kansas, trying to get all these offensive linemen in on the same week, and another complimentary visit bonus for him along with Richardson. And then outside linebacker Dan Sellers finally ready for that visit. He'll come in week 8 as well and visit with Larson Decker, get a complimentary visit bonus then. Maybe Dan Sellers can get Larson Decker to turn it around. Now we'll just do a quick fly through of our board, taking a look at who's progressed where. Great progress with O'Brien and Johnson, expecting commitments from them. Also Marcus Webster, but obviously Larson Decker still being a little difficult. I did not show Dan Irby for the reason that we're steadily pulling away with him and he's not ready for a visit quite yet, but we've got a lot of guys, you know, who we're making pretty good progress with. And a lot of the guys on our board right now, a lot of these guys are just runaway players. I'm not really looking to chase people this year. If you don't want to play for us, I don't really have a space for you. But taking a look at the new guys, first place for Foster, up to 6th for Smith, 3rd for Hayward, 4th for Sherman, 2nd for Zach Carroll, great progress there, 3rd for Avery, 3rd for Fields, 1st for McKinney Still, 2nd for Pete Davis, right behind Southern Miss, 2nd for Kevin Godfrey, 2nd for Johnny Glover, and into 6th for Kevin Fields. So great progress being made already as we jump up 540 points. And we also offered him a scholarship, so that's going to probably be a big reason for that. Roman Smith up 260 points. We're still behind Auburn and right on the outside of that projected cutoff, but still making very good progress at 18% locked. Hayford 17% locked. Now we're into third place behind Stanford and Wisconsin. I am not letting Stanford have Andre Hayford. Right on the edge of cutoff range for Blake Sherman, 305 up from last week, so great progress there. Zach Carroll up 460. From last week, and now 105 points behind the Georgia Bulldogs. So I'm loving this move. We got rid of a kicker that was being complicated. We got hopefully another one that's going to be coming pretty smoothly. But Mickey Avery up 410 points from last week. That is a straight jump in terms of the points we're putting into him. Same thing almost with Kevin Burns, 480 from last week. We're putting 495 into him. Still leading pretty well with Brian McKinney, pulling ahead very heavily. And I'm going to start kind of taking away points from McKinney down to 50 now from where he was before, because this is going to be a runaway race for us. But Pete Davis have not offered him a scholarship yet. This is something we can do now with the freed up points from Noah Harrell. And we move up 455 points from last week. Kevin Godfrey up 465 from last week. That is a straight jump in terms of points put into him. And we're right behind Florida State by 65 points. Johnny Glover, who's still kind of a mystery to me, 415 up from last week. That is another straight jump for us. Right behind Nebraska. I expect a jump this week. And then Kevin Fields making a big time splash and already into sixth place for him, right behind Florida State, but we still got a long way to go. But moving into subscribers now, Ashley O'Dea did end up committing to Purdue as I expected. I can't see the visit points for Purdue, but I expect that would have knocked us out anyway. And then moving on to fullback, the only fullback that we had from the subscribers, Oscar Acevedo from Waukegan, Illinois, going to Northwestern. And we will play Northwestern next year. And now we're moving into week 6, or obviously we're already in week 6, but we're taking on the Buffalo Bulls as conference play is about to get started. And I'm actually pretty excited because we get to go against subscriber Jay Grimes. I actually forgot to mention that last week when we played the Bearcats, we went up against linebacker Corey Bonko, but he was like third on their depth chart at middle linebacker, so we didn't get a chance to actually see him on the field. But that, guys, is it for the Week 5 recruiting update. We are now in Week 6 at 2-1, getting ready to take on the 2-2 Buffalo Bulls as conference play is about to get started on the road in Buffalo, New York. So for the people asking, where is my recruit? Those of you that were subscribers that got added to the board for the list this year, what I'm going to do this year is show you guys where you commit. So I'm not going to be doing like a week-by-week update or anything like that, because obviously you guys are going to be flip-flopping. That happened a lot last year. But I am watching the board every week, so when someone does commit somewhere, I will show it in the end of a video. So thank you all for tuning in. Hope you guys enjoyed. We are ready for week 6 and conference play. See you guys then. Thanks for watching.